So if you remember, we left off in chapter 3, Peter and John had just gone to the temple to pray. And outside the temple, the gate beautiful, the beggar was laying there, and he had been laying there for many years. As we'll learn later on, he's almost 40 years old, around that is what Scripture says. And so he's been laying outside the temple for a very long time, begging, as you know, the Jewish leaders would pass him by, and people who were going to church would pass him by. But on this day, the Holy Spirit prompted Peter and John to stop, and to not just do something practical, but to do something most divine, which was the Spirit Himself, and to offer this man for the first time, have you heard the good news of Jesus? And not only did it supernaturally, you know, manifest in his body as a healing, it also, you can tell as the story goes on, and as this man, you can tell the inside of him is changed to reflect what has happened outside as well. So, that's where we're at tonight. And so, you know, as you're standing here at the temple, you can imagine this healing has probably drawn a lot of attention from different people that are going back and forth from the temple. And if you remember, if you went in the Gospel of Mark before we went to Acts, there were always Jewish leaders, religious leaders, who took offense to anyone who grabbed the attention of the people, because that's what they lived off of, was their pride and their arrogance and their self-righteousness. And so, just think about this, a big healing right outside the temple, you're going to attract the attention of the leaders in Jesus. And so, they're going to come out. So, we left off with Peter preaching this sermon where he tells them, and because the response as the public was watching him, they were surprised that God would heal this beggar who's been laying out at the gate for so long. And he reminds them, hey, God is Jehovah. He was the same God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and he's done all these miracles. Remember what he did in Moses and Egypt, and how he delivered Gideon and the army, all these different things. It's kind of what he's trying to remind them, this is our heritage, this is who we are. Don't be surprised. Worship him. Worship God for what he's doing, and never point to us as anyone can do. It's amazing what he's doing, worshiping him today. Because it's going to have nothing to do with us. And so we talked about the importance of preaching the gospel to ourselves last week, and how, because of what Peter was declaring, that we need to remind ourselves, that the psalmist would, hey, why are you downcast, oh my soul? Why are you discouraged with whatever you're going through? Don't you remember how God has delivered you in the past? Don't let circumstances fool you. God is still God. He's still in control. He's still all-powerful, all-knowing. He'll move in our circumstances. Now, the point is to preach to ourselves and to preach that to others, is that Peter and John are doing. But the problem is, not everyone is going to receive the gospel with open hands. In fact, if you walk outside these four walls, the world calls it judgmental and bigot and wrong for sharing the love of Jesus with individuals. How do you hear that all the time? We hear it more and more. It's growing. All because of pride, man will refuse to acknowledge God. That's what Romans 1 says. We refuse to acknowledge Him in our lives. So the gospel of Jesus, the message of God to love the world, that He gave us His Son, becomes a stumbling block for many. Even against the impossible odds of changing a blackened heart of mankind, the Holy Spirit is still working in us today. And Peter is met with opposition here right off the bat. But what we're going to see is the Holy Spirit is still working despite the opposition. Let's open up this chapter with verses 1 through 3 together. It says that they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people of Capernaum and Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. So, when you read through the Gospels, we talked about this a little bit when we opened, but the Pharisees were the biggest ones who would come against Jesus. We saw it time and time again. And what they were frustrated with was that their man-made religious traditions, the ones they put on top of God's law, the ones they put on top of the teaching of the prophets to, you know, make themselves look better or to make themselves feel better about themselves, Jesus is breaking those left and right. And they were arguing, wait a minute, don't follow Jesus. He's breaking our traditions. Because Jesus was teaching them, wait a minute, these aren't God's laws. even worse silly things that we like to do, and they're hurting people. And that's not what I'm here for. I'm here for the broken. I'm here for the ones who need me to sit, or the ones that need the position. And so he's just arguing, and he's not arguing back. He's allowing them to argue at him, and he simply responds to them in love and instruction time and time again until they wanted to kill him. But now we have the Sadducees walking out. But to give you kind of a little bit of understanding about who they are, they're realists. They're the ones who, you know, we don't believe in, a second coming, or, you know, we don't believe in miracles or the divine, all these different things, much like the generation that we live in today. Why? Because we have grown stagnant. Remember, there's 400 years of silence between the Old Testament and the New, that Jesus came on the scene. There's a reason for that. That's what I've told you time and time again. I've shown you wonders in the heaven. I have delivered you time and time again. But now I need to be silent until Jesus comes in. And so they can be complacent. I think of them like the Nacho Libre movie, the guy who goes, I believe in silence. You know, that's what these guys would have been like. But I don't believe in faith. I only believe in science. But if you look at science over the last, 60 years or more, time and time again, things have been proven to be accurate at this point by the scientists. There's no concrete foundation. It's all about feeling. One guy told me that, trying to prove God exists by science, doesn't exist by science, is like trying to weigh a chicken in your left. Think about the since even God does the supernatural, he's saying, I don't fit in your box. I don't have to do things your way. Just because you can't wrap your mind around what I just did does not mean I didn't do it. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9 tells us, my ways are not your ways. Even my thoughts are not your thoughts. So when God is sovereign, we're talking about that. He is in control. He's God. He's majestic and beyond all words. And his mere presence alone makes the wisest of men a man. Because it is. It's like my student who told me, God, you don't have to do that. You don't have to do this. You don't. They don't understand how the bigger picture works. They have a small little taste of it. But that's what it's like when we tell God, you don't know what you're doing. You don't understand it. You can either humble yourself before the mighty hand of God, or out of love, he allows us to resist him. But there's no method. As soon as we're the gospel, we keep proclaiming God's word. And I remember, as a young pastor, my dad, this has been many years ago, he was telling the story as he was calling a church about very similar to this, but it was Baptist. And so he got called there to the district overseer, and it wasn't a tribal chapel, it was a denomination. And so they said, hey, the last two pastors have been laid off. And so he's like, I'll go out and see what's going on. And so when he lands there, the congregation is great. They're doing potlucks, and the people are just wonderful. They're inviting and welcoming him. And then he's like, I don't know what's going on here. A lot of pots was being ran off. And so the first Sunday morning, we got to preach. And as soon as the microphone got handed to him, the atheist neighbor started using his chainsaw to cut up wood outside the church gate. And this went on every Sunday for quite a few weeks. And my dad, very young, probably in his mid-20s, had no idea what to do, what to do with this. And finally, one Sunday morning, something happened. The Spirit just moved on my dad, and he said, at the congregation, he got into his text, and he got about halfway through reading it again, and the chainsaw just struck up, and he said, I'll be right back. And he said, come on. And so he went outside, and he just talked about how all I could do for this man wasn't bad, I wasn't angry. I just kept telling him how much Jesus loves me. And how much he said, come pray for me. And the guy got so angry. He said, Pastor, get away from me, get away from me, get away from me. And he says, I can't stop telling you that Jesus loves you. He says, and finally, the boy got so angry that he wanted to cut off my dad's head with a chainsaw. And I said, what would him? And my dad, and only in full of the boldness of the Holy Spirit, he said, brother, I intend to let you, and even if you touch that chainsaw to my neck, if God doesn't want me to do it, he will never do it. But if he does, he will never do it. He will never do it. Only if it's constant to finish the job you have to do. Now, the guy falls off and goes into his house, and about a month later, as he's sitting in the back room, there was a guy who said, come in and turn the church. and became one of the strongest church leaders that my dad had ever seen with that whole statement of pastoring. Why? Because he said that the love of Christ and the name of Jesus is more powerful than God the Father or whatever we come up against. He has that kind of faith. And I can't help but ask, where has the faith of the church been? Myself included. There are times where that we are ministering and working that study for what we can't do all these cases. And you're wondering, how in the world, if you're telling the person the gospel, then help me to fix this. But they can. But they do it time and time again. I can't help but believe the greatest news of God were born in the midst of the greatest depravity. We look through scripture, we look through history, it comes every single time. Even in the midst of adversity, the name of Jesus produces fruit. And watch me what happens in verse 4 together. So in the midst of them coming out and proclaiming or resting on the day, but many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to be about 5,000 people. Now, think about Peter's first sermon in Acts chapter 2. Remember, the Holy Spirit had just fallen. There's these crazy signs. People are seeing tongues of fire. They're hearing the languages come out that they have their native background of the mighty works of God. And, you know, all these people are coming up saying, what in the world is going on? And Peter's, you know, prophetically proclaiming, this is what we've been waiting for our entire life. And 3,000 people came to the Lord. And you have this one tiny little individual baby who was healed from disappointment. And all that meant was 5,000 people were saved. That's what happened. What was the difference? And then the Holy Spirit is doing all this awesomeness, and then we have just this simple, quiet miracle that most people didn't even see. They only heard about what happened. And I personally believe the personal testimony that each and every one of us have is a powerful piece to God's hand. You know, Jesus' message in the gospel is super distinguished. That's the magical power that the name of Jesus has. But Jesus has the grace to include us to the point where he mixes in, where we say, Jesus loves you, but here's what he's also done in my life personally. That personal testimony, of each one of us, no matter our backstory, we can have a really cool testimony, or we can grow up in the church and know we're not that cool because, we kind of registered him in the stock and all this, and this lady with that racial background, and got rid of it until last month. No, he gave her every single one of us from death, despite the fact that she was a powerful, perfect tool in the name of Jesus, that we can never be ashamed of our faith, that we can just share it with our friends, our family, our co-workers, our strangers, and Jesus even can share it with anyone. That's a whole new level. Now, think of the spiritual 5,000 new followers of Jesus in one day. You do not think that would get the attention you need. That's going to raise an eyebrow. Not only just the physical, but think of the spiritual aspect of it. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 11 real quick. I want to read a very popular scripture, but one time we like to read off about six verses in it. Hebrews chapter 11, beginning at verse 32, says, talking about the witnesses. It says, "But what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, the rock, Samson, Barak, and of David, and Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness, became mighty in war, that foreign armies to flight, women received back their dead by resurrection." Now, we love to stop here. And these are good scriptures. I encourage people with these. But I think for some reason the new style of teaching, we get away from the hard truth of why Jesus came. finish the rest of these verses. So that sounds great. Who in here raised servants would be astonished if you just dropped them up to the next? But yes, the or you know, put down kingdoms, or you know, even rulers, you know, were set up where God has told us to set up a kingdom of righteousness, a kingdom of where people are taken care of, and you know, the less of what we consider in society is just as important as the most. That would be wonderful. But the writer of Hebrews has just got there. Look at verse 35, the last part. It says, and I'm talking to the same witnesses. Some did all these things, but some were tortured, refusing to accept the news, so they might rise again to a better death. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were fined too, they were killed with a sword, they went out in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wondering about the deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. All of these, though, commended to their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, but apart from us, they could not be repaid. So, you know, it's important to understand that as Christians, and what I always talk about is, you know, God wants to bless us. There's this ultimate desire that, you know, when we get to heaven, we are going to be lavished upon as sons and daughters in Christ, and there will be things that we get lavished on here on earth. But I think where we get to the point is where, you know, just because we are filled with the Holy Spirit, just like Peter was only 2 chapters ago, this indwelling power of the Holy Spirit that you offer today that makes us more than conquerors, doesn't mean that we won't go through temptation. It doesn't mean that we won't be hit with trials, that we won't be hit with temptations, that we won't be strong our very weaknesses in our mortality. To have faith when all is good, so don't worry about it. Yes, we're going to have a good day. He said, son, faith and time is good. How do you think we're going to come back? He said, our faith is allowed to be tested, that God brings us through things to the earth. Or we enter into eternity's gate, just like the writer of Hebrews was saying. They did not back down whether the kingdom was conquered or whether they refused to be let go as a group of people brought here in this prison, because we will not denounce our faith to you. We will take what it happens, and we know that when it happens, God's going to be the one who happens. And look, these are the ones the writer of Hebrews says, these are the ones who were committed to the faith. Our faith is perfected in God. Now let's see what Peter and John and Jesus say with the kind of work done. It says in verse 5, and the next day the rulers and elders and scribes gathered together in Jerusalem. Cornelius and the high priest, Caiaphas and John and Alexander, all who were the high priestly family, and when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, by what power or by what name did you do this? Now in the Old Testament, this is really important because they're the priests, so the high family. We've got Peter and John now because by the Old Testament law, if you claimed to do a miracle by any other name than Jehovah, you were to be stoned. So perhaps they might have the rocks in their hands, and they could have been them right back to their bones, so they're, you know, inquiring to Peter and John, saying, you know, I hope Peter and John says they did this. They're waiting for that. Let's see how Peter, you know, died 60 days earlier. He denied Jesus to a teenage girl, calling him waiting again because they were thinking he knew he lived Jesus. And he denies it 3 times. Let's see what the power reacts to. Look at verse 8. This says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, If there's a part in the scripture where you want to underline that right there, he was filled with the Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders. So let's talk like this for a second. Before he gives the answer, you know, as a pastor, This is something I always have to wrestle with. You know, what if I'm ever put into the circumstance where, you know, someone comes to the door and they burst in and says, you know, Christianity is no longer welcome in America. We're going to close everything down. If you keep preaching, we're going to throw you in jail. Or worse, you know, we could kill you. We could, you know, we pitch you to death for your faith. What would I do? I would like to say, I'm going to keep preaching the word of Jesus. I think any of us would do that. That would be our heart's desire. But his verse gives the answer to that question. It says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit. It's important to understand that Peter heard this 60 days earlier. On our own, when we're asked that question, we can't say in our own power that we're going to continue with Jesus. Something really special happens. It's like we learned that Jesus is often the first person to ask him. He gives us the faith to believe in him. He gives us the faith to walk in him. That makes mind blowing that he would go all out to take all self righteousness, to take all self glory out of the picture and say, it is all mine. Even your walk, I am doing it for you and through you with the Holy Spirit. But right here he says, the Spirit fills him. So when we live the way of this question, what am I going to do? When this time comes, this is scripture proclaiming, when that time comes, the Spirit will rise up. And Jesus told his disciples, he said, they're going to come question you, they're going to come do all these things. Don't worry about what you're going to say in that time frame, because what's going to happen is the Spirit is going to speak. That is awesome. We don't have to even worry about that muster of the courage or the faith that will be given to us by the angel of the Holy Spirit. First time we go down to say that, and the Spirit is not talking. If we are dealing with the enemy today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, and God raised from the dead, by him, this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation for no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And you have the hard gospel. There's no other way to be saved but with the Lord, with Jesus, the God of Jesus. Now, the thought that interesting how the Holy Spirit did Peter take any praise? So they asked him, how did you do this? By what name did you do this? So the Holy Spirit perfectly uttered the words. This has nothing to do with it. This is Jesus who did this. Don't blame me. This is the work of Jesus in his life. You know, Jesus is often rejected by many as the cornerstone of God's plan for redemption. We should not be shocked by that. Before those, when Solomon's temple was being built, I think it's a great poetry. When Solomon's temple was being built, the stones that were cut for the foundation and the walls were cut somewhere else. And so they were perfectly measured and shaped by the master builders, and they would send it to the building site of Solomon's temple. Says, here's the bricks that you need, the walls that you need, and follow these plans and diagrams. And it said that at one point, this funny looking stone came, and all the workers that could not figure out, the builders could not figure out where this stone fits. So what they did is, this must be just a mistake. There must be something wrong with the stone. It wasn't shaped right. And so what they did is they rolled it down the hill to Gehenna. Gehenna in the Jewish area, that's where all the dead went to. It was told that it was always constantly on fire. It was burning the refuge of the city. And a lot of times, you have Jesus, and some other teachers will refer to Gehenna as hell itself, because they were stakes and because they're burning and rotting the person. Well, what happened is they were getting to the point where they needed the cornerstone. And so the boys said, the cornerstone's not here, it has not arrived yet. And so they sent word back to the master builders, and they said, hey, you have not sent the cornerstone. We need it. We need this to start the work. And the message came back. We sent it to you. And this is the story. And so they look at it. And here now is that the cornerstone that they had rejected and rolled down the hill, that was his plan. That's called everything together. So when Jesus references this, or when the disciples reference this, and the Holy Spirit brings it up, it's a constant reminder that, hey, remember, even the practicality, we didn't even see what the master did and made it clear to be disregarded. But it didn't make it to less valuable. It didn't make it less important. It was still the most crucial piece to build the temple. He is the cornerstone. Jesus is the cornerstone. And this is the world that we are studying that we need to prepare. Jesus only went to the depths of hell, the grave, and the death itself to be respected. And come back to life. And the cornerstone of God comes as a rock of salvation. And this is where I get my talents now for where we're at in Scripture. 1 Peter 2:5. So this is Peter proclaiming this to the Holy Spirit, and then later, inspired by the Holy Spirit, he writes the letter of 1 Peter 2:5. It says, "You yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house." As the kingdom of God is built around Jesus, we are the stones that he gathers together to build his church. Hence the name, one of the reasons he put the name, Gathering Stones. It's a reminder of what the work Jesus is doing here himself. As he promised in Matthew 16:18, Peter had written, "Hey, upon this rock," so Peter was referenced as a pebble, then what Peter did right there when he expressed the faith that was given to him by God, that Jesus first to God, he said, "Peter, the pebble, upon this rock, that faith that God has given you to believe in me is what I'm going to build my church upon." So in God's plan, as many stones, we are called to be close to one another. That's usually why the cornerstone is, rejected, because it doesn't look distinct, because of all these pieces that God is putting together around Jesus. This is the foundation upon which I am building my kingdom. And if many stones think about this, we have to be close to one another. That's the body of Christ. We have to be next to one another, which means more often than not, because we are still blessed and tense, we are going to do what? Let each other do it. They will help you. We need to be trying to think, how do you do these guys? It's so hard to grow in our faith and to depend on the outside of what's really happening, but we did that so that we can stand each other behind. But if it's coming to God, let me free this, God. Help me free this, God. Help me show you love. And what's happening is he's making us fit into the body of Christ. And that's the beautiful thing about sanctification. It's an ongoing process. That when we're all centered God, Paul talks about, hey, right now, you can see into a new being the reflection of Christ to care for every day. Because the wonder, being the new this is a process. This is a training ground for the maturity of worship. It's how we're starting it right now. In the moment that we're completing, we're going to be repeating. So, when the bride, if the task is complete, do you finish with the bride? It's different from the bride. So, as much as we disrupt the process, as much as we it's uncomfortable to be with other people, it's uncomfortable to grow like this. If we can see the blessed hope that is to come, that's what faith is about. And yet, Christ, you got to be dependent on God for this person. God, be dependent on God to be next to you. How do you get to know him? How do you get to see who you are? what you need to start to live and what you need to start to be. So back to the passage here, to proclaim Jesus healed with a song of war effect. Look at this picture in the portrait to see what happens. Because it was proclaimed, we did this. Oh, no, Jesus did this. We didn't do it, but Jesus did this. First thing we want to say, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished. And they recognized that they had been with Jesus. But seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say, not to whisper. You know, much like the Ephesians, when the woman who was caught in adultery was thrown at Jesus' feet, and the law said, hey, when this happens, choose to be stoned, and Jesus tells him. And if we had never seen who would ask to, they're going to pass the system. And yet, the older ones still want to walk as if they're directing it back to first, and they left the others to find that place, and they walked away. They could not pass the system. Now, there's two reasons that these guys that we want, I see a scripture called the Lord, but just a lot of people doing. I can come out, you know. The first thing we look at is in verse 13. It says, they were uneducated men. They saw this. But God didn't say that to them. He was honest about the wisdom. But what stood out to them most is he said, they knew they had been with Jesus. That's really important. Time and time again, we see it in scripture, and before the last week, an opportunity to proclaim it, that it is a relationship with Jesus that changes us, nothing else. Not a program, not some political Bible study, it is their things to help, but it is an ongoing relationship with Jesus. If we think we're going to go to one conference, or, hear one preacher, and, it's going to change my life forever, those things are good and they help. But it's an ongoing relationship, having him hold our hands and walk us through what he proclaims. I will follow you, even to the end of the world. That's what it means. That's what he saw us. This ongoing relationship with Peter and John. You know, how many times can we be accused of that? We got from Jesus. They saw it, the relationship that we had with Jesus, that they knew what was going on. The second thing I see is, besides the relationship of why they let him go, or didn't do much, is they knew they had been around Jesus, but they could say nothing because of the miracle that stood before them. I don't know how many times people have worked out on missions to, disprove Jesus or disprove God, and they start going around and start interviewing people, they start hearing testimonies, they start seeing what God is doing. They fought and trained people who were atheists and preachers, people who were agnostic, they start to believe all these different things. Why? Because they cannot understand the divine power, but when they see it for themselves, they can no longer deny it. I heard about the man that died for that son. I heard that Jesus transformed his life. The woman, I realized I know him. I passed by him through life. Even for the news coming to the people. I know who he was this morning. I know who he was yesterday. And that is not the same person I see before me. Something behind this happened. The man's testimony, the life that was broken now, was clear. They could not find him in the life. So verses 15 and 18, or verses 15 through 18, read like this. But when they had commanded them to leave the council, they confirmed with one another, saying, what shall we do with these men? So that a noble sign has been performed through them is evident to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and we can't deny it. But in order that it may spread no further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name. So they called them and charged them not to speak or to teach at all in the name of Jesus. Now, one of the practical Pharisees is so upset, he, God doesn't move this way. God doesn't do it this way because, we can't wrap our minds around it. And all of them in the combined wisdom could not match God's divine nature here. They had to look at this and say, he is the creator. He is the master builder, not us. He was someone, but they did not turn toward him. They just knew they were out of boxes. And how can God use that to you? So, you know, we're looking at what's going on here, and they're making up their minds, and if we can't do anything else, we're threatened. And so, you know, the time and time again, we're up here, where people are being more intimate than they can Jesus. And if that's my point, it's not a scary message. And Jesus came because he comes. God's so with the world. It's amazing that he gave his son. This is how much he loved us. But he gave his son. But yes, there is a God. There is a place for coming, but you don't ever have to experience it. For us to believe that, that's good news. That's why we call it the good news of the gospel, the good news of Jesus. But because they were blinded by sin, it's like the rules of the case of family here, is blinded by their own desire to be loved by the people, to be leadership, they don't want to be like the power of the gospel. So, how can we be used by Peter and John here to disrupt the enemy's work? And it may not be physical healing, but it could be. God could do that in the moment. A sinner is in great pain. I haven't seen this, but I've seen some things I can't explain myself. Thank God. No man can be helpful. It is him. But there's also a more simple way. Jesus could teach and ask us, hey, are you giving me sick? I mean, can you turn the windows in the earth? What about? And we've seen that child of his name, but the ministry is going on in the community in the classroom. They're going to a prison, they're offering a coat, they're simply just offering a poor being all these things being in the name of Jesus. And we think that's the way that Jesus does things, because he takes that. So here, in our verses, Peter and John are arrested for the message of Jesus. The question then is about nothing to keep them forward, but threaten them over their faith. That's all we can do. Hey, this is more than we can wrap our mind around clearly. Even though our law says we are stoning you, we can't because there's something greater at work here than even ourselves. What we do is to do the work of Jesus and come to Christ. Don't you dare come back to me once again. And then you can see behind them. You know, when we're in the hilltop of the distraction, you know, we met some pretty much characters. And so they let us know. They didn't ask you. But behind them, you can see the faces of the children. You can see the faces of the ones who were made who did help us. What do we do? Peter and John, they're in the text. And these guys are making money first as the leaders of the community. But yet, I just thought, well, it's not every people accepted by the name of Jesus. And what do you see? You don't know. What would be our answer? Let's look at Peter and John. It says in verse 19, that Peter and John answered them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot speak of what we have seen and heard. And when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding no way to punish them because their people, for all were praising God for what had happened. So the man of whom the son Peter was fulfilled was more than 40 years old. So they could not stop talking about Jesus despite the facts. How to get to that point in our lives? It comes back to the more time we spend with Jesus, the stronger and bolder our faith becomes. Because we realize you being the answer to you. He says, is this right in your government to throw me in jail with you and try to stand because of my faith? You need to judge that. But that's not going to stop me from proclaiming to Jesus with what see the hell that tasted in my own life. Think about it. What do we talk about most? All these different things, you know. All these things that I know that you guys are doing in the world. Why is it sometimes so natural for us to hurl or become evangelists? for them to accept Jesus. But why did it become so natural for us to do that? Because whatever that has become has become very important to us in our lives. So we have to find a friend that we really could continue to rely on. So there's a fitting place beside my work. So I'll start there, one of the best stories in town. There's this wonderful and constant breath. And so I think that several times it's really good. And it's really an honor to people actually at work for some reason, good things that I'm paying them to go and, you know, grab some lunch or whatever. But on my work day, it has gained the name Bigger Burger. Okay, which I like. So apparently, 3 or 4 years ago, someone who used to work at Mission, installed a person who had prevention to this. And so that became the reputation to him of the place. Now, I have eaten it, I have tasted this. And I've come to the point where the food is so good that I wouldn't have to call the person who didn't want it because it's just good food. Now, it's interesting that I have continued to feel this to where now 2/3 of my employees have now gone and visited the quote, delivery. And now they love it, they are now going there and want it. Because I have tasted it for myself, I've known I did not drag someone else's experience to, you know, worry over me. I knew it for myself that the food was good. Now, the psalmist writes something like this in Psalm 34:8. He says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Now, I share with a funny story, but how do we become truly bold in our spiritual walk, truly to the point where we're unwavering, you know, we are effective Jesus followers? And how do we continue to say it? It's because it's been time with him. It's been time with him. We will probably believe this each other. We won't be prone to feel the depth and the riches and the peace and the mind that we do. But how rich God really is, how blessed we are in this goodness, this gift of Jesus and his salvation. God, he owns not just everything that we can see, but everything in the universe and beyond that, and how he creates things out of nothing. We can't even comprehend that, that his bank account is so full. But speaking of the universe, he can teach us, didn't even scratch the surface of what he could do with the wealth that he has spiritually. But you won't be prone to share that with others. You won't be prone to tell that for others. I just tell you for me. And we thank you this morning. And we are proud of both the Jesus story and the experience of the Savior of the Jesus. And that's what I encourage you to do. You're coming in with an acceptable and rich sort of way of being that there has to be something we can add to your family, to your work, and to your living, to your habit, and to all of those things. Taste the beauty of God. Come on. And do it. If maybe you're feeling like the enemy and you're just waiting for more to do it, I mean, it's still in you. That's a lot of time to wait for God to deliver you. And it is something to do with this. And it is something to do with the money of time that the time of God has been called. He says, we are that one and one and two is person. It's not something to do with the glory of I think I've talked about this in the interview for 40, over 40 years with you. This is a wonderful life. 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 So if you like that, you know, I pray for you and keep trusting, keep waiting, keep believing, and keep crying out because as you can, this is a wonderful life. God, we just thank you tonight as we begin to see the world and we're humble at your majesty. It's oftentimes a fair that we're a bit familiar with passages and we just continue to grow in our mind as we've got new ways to look at it and new ways to explore who we are and get back to the Lord. We need to do this for the kind of stuff we need to do in heaven. We need to do this for the kind of stuff. the wonderful city. They're trying to act as prophets, trying to act to get through. They're trying to, life is so busy that other things are taking priority. So we need that relationship. I think it's a good thing.